being a big question mark in summer. So question marks for both teams. One of them has to look forward, and we'll have to see who'll state their claim, at least on game one.
Yep. We'll go ahead and move right into the pick and ban for game one here. Lindron and Solon haven't seen these guys play together starting on the roster since Freak of Freaks played against Rock Tigers last time. So it's been quite a while. Lindron did sub in their third game versus Samsung, the regular split, but they lost that. So we'll see how much improvement has been made since that time. Malzahar, Talia gonna be banned away. So Afrika paying a lot of respect over to both Kuzan and Trace, because we've seen that Malzahar come out in the top lane several times for him.
You also have to remember, on a broader sense, it's kind of amazing that Jhin Air is available to play this game, because if things had changed just a few weeks ago, it was only on the last day of the season they confirmed they wouldn't be in relegations. If you go to relegations, you forfeit all your Worlds qualifier points. So only because they stayed out of the relegation tournament are they eligible to play today. And we remember a year ago where GBM on his gangplank hard carried Jhin Air to the finals of the regional qualifier after an awful season for Jhin Air, and they only came one set, ironically, against KT short of going to Worlds. So let's see if Jhin Air can match that, as the fans have already come through, and it's going to be a first pick Echo. Trace's gangplank predictably is banned away, but Lissandra has been the pick for both Kuzan and Mickey in the last weeks of the season. Both of them 4-2. Since these teams have struggled, both of them with negative win rate on the season, there aren't many picks that are like net positive for both mid laners, but Lissandra has been that, and that's why we'll see it jump up the draft priority.
Yeah, Echo locked in right away. Lissandra, as mentioned, very big shared champion between both of the mid laners. Mickey, in the recent games, I guess I can't really call them recent, but their most recent games, it was all about the Lissandra, but also the Karma and the Twisted Fate were mixed in there with Varus a couple of times. So there's still some options that Mickey has available to him that we've seen in the past, but we're going to find out if he's brought anything new to the table. Right now, it's looking like a big no.
Yeah, Mickey played two games of the Karma against Samsung. Again, didn't look convincing. This is an assassin-minded player. This is an aggressive-minded player, and the team didn't play to their win conditions. That's kind of been the story for Afrika after their kind of big rise when they beat SK Telecom in the second round robin, is they've been drafting comps that look like they have an identity. You'll see a Pope comp, you'll see a split pushing comp, and yet they'll still brute force team fight. They're kind of a bit mindless about some specific win conditions. So you need to really pick a comp that's straightforward and play to their win conditions if they are to win a best of five. Because you need to show a higher level of average performance to win a series like this.
Yeah. And interestingly enough, we're going to see Songwon going for this elite when the Gragas is open and available to him, but just wants to opt in for this selection instead of going for, which has, you know, been one of the more prominent junglers across all regions.
Yeah, only Rek'Sai taken off the part. That's the consensus top jungle pick in Korea and around the world, but as you say, at least as a grab over Gragas, especially on 6:15 before the Gragas nerfs comes through, is a bit of surprise, but certainly some big lockdown ganks. You also deny something like Lissandra at least, which can be perma CC and really force some highly defensive play in mid, but priority picks are still available. We're seeing Gnar fall through to the third round, of course, because the Echo was already selected on the left side. And here we go. Afrika brought out the Kog'Maw pick, brought it back into the meta, the on-hit build that Sangyun innovated that took down SK Telecom. It's just they kind of haven't really drafted smartly around it since, but you look at this comp, you've got the Karma utility. This is basically the new age Juggernaut, because this comp is very much about Kog'Maw going to the front. Passive blows can come through. Braum passive powerful. The shields from Karma. This is a Sangyun focused comp, and given that Sangyun has looked wildly different from being a really top AD to struggling, the spotlight's on him in game one.
Yeah, we'll see. But this last pick is going to be coming through for Jhin Air. We'll be looking for that support, what they're going to try to lock up, because that Braum Kog'Maw bottom lane, it's going to be pretty brutal. I mean, the Braum going to be serving quite well. Has a lot to block, the ricochets, the boomerang blade, as well as the Gragas barrels that can come out to really keep Sangyun safe, stop him from getting bounced into Jhin Air. So it's going to be on them to try to dive into the back line. It's going to be the Tahm Kench, so they have that delivery service with the Abyssal Voyage to try to come around the backside. Could bring Trace in with the Meganar perhaps, but Kuzan as well. Be damn sure he's going to be looking for that glacial path in. Try to just frozen tomb down on himself, lock up the members of the Freak of Freaks. that Pilot can just swoop in, start ricocheting people to death.
They had a lot of different options with their support. It was probably going to be a melee support dim they were drafting into Braum. You're confident to run the Trundles and Tarix of the world. Sivir Tarix have a lot of synergy. They could have just gone for the Cosmic Radiance hard engage because you see Cogmore want to get on top and kill that Cogmore. The other side would have been the Trundle, being able to shred the Echo, kill the frontline, and deny Cogmore from doing damage by proxy, but they go for the Tahm Kench, and usually I think of Tahm Kench as a denial pick, but maybe it very much is. Launching the Gragas into the backline with the Abyssal Voyage, explosive cast, separating the Cogmore and going from there.
It's just interesting to me that the Tahm Kench is going to be the answer from Jhin Air. But let's go ahead and get ready to load in onto the map. As you can see, we have the 2016 World Championship logo decked out around the studio and in the booths.
I mean, all the regional leagues have got their champions. Now it's all about Worlds, Akil. It's all about going to the world stage. It'll be the first time for both these teams at Worlds, and really excited to see what they have on 615.
As am I. Well, let's get ready to go ahead, load up onto Summoner's Rift, and get to it with this Game 1 of Freak of Freaks versus Jhin Air Green Wings. It's sure to be a long and probably bloody set. Alrighty, welcome to Summoner's Rift. You can see the Cloud Drake going to be starting us off. And right now, looks like a Freak of Freaks going to be running three members down to this bottom side. Some cheers coming out there for Jhin Air.
Seen a lot of pretty stale level ones around the world on patch 6.15, given standard metas has very much become the requirement. But Afrika were always that team to innovate. We've seen these guys pull off some very creative gank paths at level one. Camp lanes to look for a kill. They are three-man invading, but let's wait and see exactly what Afrika want from this level one, or if it's just a defensive fan that's, again, been pretty much the standard around the world.
Well, not going to find too much on the bottom side of the map, so they're going to go ahead and peel back. Looks like we might just have Songyun and Snowflower starting up with the Krugs, and Pilot and Jay for the Grump, so going to be pretty standard stuff to kick things off.
Yeah, so let's talk about Afrika. Again, we talked about how they re-innovated the Cogmore pick, the on-hit build, with the likes of the Ginsu Rageblade coming out from Sangyun. It's just they've been playing Cogmore in a lot of different comps. They haven't actually been playing the Juggernaut. Actually, Longju was the first team to play the Karma-esque Juggernaut comp during recent memory, and it's been more Afrika just kind of running Cogmore because Sangyun's confident on it. This time, their comp has a true identity, but we've seen them pick poke comps and then look for team fights they have no hope to win just because of what they've drafted. So that can they play to the Juggernaut, which is very much about Cogmore in the front and all the shields and all the peel focused on making that Cogmore carry a fight.
Well, that was one of the things I wanted to touch on before we started loading into the game was actually, if you remember, when this Cogmore pick originally came out for Songyun versus SK Telecom, Wolf, of course, big Tahm Kench player, is one of the first ones to really pick that up in the support role in Korea. The Cogmore absolutely devastated Wolf's Tahm Kench. That was one of the biggest things, was that Tahm Kench was a non-factor. He would try to come in, get those tongue lashes down to lock up the AD carry, get the Devour, but he would just get shredded out so quickly. So it's interesting to me that Jhin Air would still draft this, especially with the more Juggernaut-esque composition that Afrika Freaks have pieced together, because it's going to make it that much more difficult to actually get on top of him when he's getting that move speed increase from the Karma Shield, when he has this Braum to sit in front and block these skill shots. But it's got to be a confidence play coming out from the Jhin Air Green Wings. You just have to wait and find out if it's going to pay off for them.
It's a really fun matchup, and it's interesting because on a simple level in a team fight, what does Tahm Kench do? He either denies someone initiating, and Juggernaut comps aren't about initiation. They're about speed and peel for a Cogmore at the front. So not going to be denying, say, an Ash Arrow with the Tahm Kench Devourer, or the Tahm Kench goes Rambo and tries to close in. And when you think of a support against Cogmore, you want someone that can help you kill that Cogmore in the backline. Tahm Kench just dies, wading slowly towards the Cogmore. So what does he provide? The Abyssal Voyage being rebuffed with setup, if you can set it up correctly, does launch a Gragas into the backline who has the explosive cast. So it's less about what Tahm Kench does and what about what he can do in coordinates with the Gnars, Gragas's, and Lissandra's of the world, as Songwon's getting really frisky.
Yeah, nice. Goes in, gets the seal away on the big Krug. Winked. That Drunken Rage coming through. Going to try to get onto him. Gets the slow. Guzan now Rav. He flashes in for the Ring of Frost. Songwon fighting off more than he can chew. He flashes away. But he is still going to go down. Mickey arriving too late to try to put the shield on him. Might have used it to speed himself up. Now Trace going low, has those double buffs. Those are going to go over to Mickey. That's a pretty crucial pickup here. Kuzan, he'll be able to make it out with the Glacial Path. But honestly, a Freak of Freaks, that's going to help them out a little bit just because Mickey is going to have so much more harass in that mid lane moving forward. But Jhin'Air still get the first blood. They'll get the bonus gold and have a very slight lead to start things off.
Sungwan went aggressive, so you can definitely see his mindset this game, but lanes were not in position to do so. So you're going to take a bit of harass in the bop. You could just look at the lanes as we were talking. Both lanes are at the halfway point. Jhin'Air, predictably, they're closer to their own jungle than the enemy can be. So unless you push in aggressively as the Karma and Echo, which is possible, we didn't see it, and yet we still saw the invade. So that's very much a rookie mistake coming through from Sungwan. Mickey spares his flushes in the end and gets double buffs, which is very oppressive on a mid lane Karma. So it might work out. It's just it could have been set up cleanly by Afrika, but predictably, it was not.
It definitely it could have been worse than it is at the moment, but getting those double buffs is pretty crucial for Mickey because not only is it just the extra damage, but having that slow from the red buff makes landing that tether so much easier for him. So he can just constantly harass Kuzan, even under the turret, as you just saw, with the Mantra Qs. So Kuzan, on that first recall, is going for the double Doran's Ring and Boots. Mickey still has not backed yet. We'll see which way he wants to take the build. Probably just going to be the Athena holding rail, you think.
And around just pushing up in top. Wow, he's actually pathing around. He's going to go for a dive, but Winged is here to cover.
This could be bad. Parallel Convergence coming out.
Haven't seen the Gragas
yet. He'll
get
the shield. The Cocoon not going to connect. Nice double hop out there for Trace. He'll keep himself safe. He'll take a little bit of damage on the exit. But overall, Freak of Freaks not going to gain much ground in the top lane. Mid's still going very much in the way of Mickey, though, starting to stretch a little bit of a CS lead. And Trace now falling behind, given all of this attention that was paid in the top lane.
But you can see that this is the time for Sungwan. Finally, we now have on your screen the time when Sungwan can have his way with the jungle of Jhin'Air. Karma, even though she hasn't shot, has once again re-harassed Kuzan out of lane. Echo was pushing up and top. This is the appropriate time to do some counter-jungling for now. Nothing actually in the jungle to steal away for the elites, but really good pressure, and with this blue buff,
oh wow, Kuzan going low, drops a frozen tomb onto himself. He'll get that heal back up to stay safe. Winged, not level 6 yet. Can't go in for the explosive cast. Now Sungwan arriving. They're trying to find the play. Tether coming through. That'll be the cocoon lining up,
but
do they have the damage? Mickey taking the turret shot. Sungwan goes in, takes a hell of a lot of damage, almost goes down. Jhin'Air, they'll be able to limp out of this lane, but a Freak of Freaks, they get traded back on pretty heavily by way of that turret, so they're going to have some recalls of their own soon.
The double buff into what will be a blue buff donation soon is going to mean basically permanent blue uptime on the mid lane Karma. During the time of the laning phase where Kuzan really can't react, it's got to go double Doran's into a Negatron Cloak. And okay, Lissandra is a champion that naturally itemizes into the Abyssal Scepter because of her short ranges, but regardless, very much an emergency build. And Mickey super confidently navigating this early laning phase for Freak of Freaks.
Yeah, not having something like that Fiendish Codex at least to start you off is really going to hurt Kuzan's damage, especially as that Chalice comes out for Mickey, so he's going to have a little bit of MR, but that increased sustain with his mana and that damage CDR from the Fiendish Codex, so he is going to be much better off and will pretty much just keep hammering away at this Lissandra and try to keep him down. Trace, though, still slipping behind about 15 CS, and this is a matchup that we saw earlier today yet again. Haunzer versus Impact, and Impact completely dominated this matchup as the Gnar, not going the same way for Trace this time around.
I was able to wake up and watch the VODs of that series, and Impact put on quite a show, even though, of course, Cloud9 did not end up winning that series. Great to see him in form. Standard metas come in, and you just see the class. One of those form is temporary, class is permanent things, that when the meta shifts, it's not so much about which top laner gets screwed over less in a lane swap, and you are able to actually fight on your own 2 feet. Impact put in a really good shift in that series.
Well, it's good to see that one of the former world champion top laners of SK Telecom is having a good season, because can't really say that much for Mar.
Oh, Marin. LGD. Pick your favorite LGD. I like Let's Get Dominated. That's my favorite. League's greatest disappointment is good too.
That's actually
between
really
that
good.
And Wayless's many names, they have some great memes. LGD.
Man, what a team! It all started with Worlds 2015.
Again, like a year ago, around this time, we all looked at LGD as one of the best three teams in the world, next to EDG and SK Telecom. And the narrative of China, you know, which came into Worlds last year as the MSI champion to now, has been night and day. So very much proving grounds for the three Chinese teams.
Honestly, though, the LGD at Worlds, despite the fairly abysmal performance given what was expected from them, I still at least got my favorite story out of that, which was Imp answering the door to his hotel room for the manager.
Ah, yes.
And he's just in leopard print underwear. And I think Flame was also laying on the bed, also in leopard print underwear. And they're just, like, hanging out, listening to music.
It was a year ago at the summer final when he came in that $7,000 shirt for his interview that Imp was just blinging out of control in 2015.
Still is, but...
Oh, I'm sure.
The team's not.
No.
That's for sure.
I mean, China's weird. There's all the streaming contracts and where the revenue really comes from. So, I mean, he probably wants to be at Worlds, but won't be this year.
I would hate to have to audit the Chinese League of Legends teams.
Killios, don't even talk about it. We've got some specific instructions.
We need an entire this agency of lawyers to come through and try to fix that one, figure that one out. But it's all right. We're in Korea, so.
And not much to figure about this particular game. First 10 minutes have been very passive stuff. Despite Sungwon having the lanes in the right spot, hasn't re-entered the jungle since he died earlier. So we see Linderung ult back into lane. And I mean, again, we're very much waiting for Sungyoon to hit a couple of items. Even though they have lane pressure, still a risk to look for a dragon fight, given the potential for teleports, at least until they were used a couple of seconds ago to come in from Jhin Air. So predictably, it's been a pretty slow start, all things considered.
Yeah, and it's surprising that neither of these AD carries have really found an opportunity to go back either. Currently both breaching 100 CS, but have yet to go in with those recalls for the first buy. I mean, we can guess that Songyun's going to be picking up the Wit's End to kick things off, then maybe into the Rudan's Hurricane.
Ironically,
the
actually,
Hurricane could come out.
If you look at the 280 carries and you wonder who's most benefited from not having to back, it has to be the Kog'Maw, because Kog'Maw's pretty happy to farm till he has the 2,500-odd gold
for
a Wit's End, whereas Sivir has the earlier power spikes. You get a BF sword, you push in the Kog'Maw, Kog'Maw misses some CS, you have a little bit of a win there, but if the Wit's End comes in really early, suddenly you go for wave clear, you end up taking all the extra hits from the on-hit damage and start losing trades. So any shot pre-2,500 gold is excellent for the Sivir and kind of questionable for the Kog'Maw, who's basically buying attack speed and maybe a non-magic mantle. But if they manage to farm 110-odd CS like they have now and back, Kog'Maw's in a pretty good spot.
Yeah, especially since he's currently up in CS by 5 and they're in the middle of the lane. So has been, you know, just missed CS coming through from Pilot. I mean, granted, Relic Shield is there for Che, and he's picking those stacks up, but same can be said for Snowflower, so it's just going to be an innate lead for Songyun on that Kog'Maw, so he'll be in a perfectly happy position, not getting out-damaged and shoved in by the Sivir.
So let's talk about how these comps come together. We know it's Juggernaut, we know that Kog'Maw's the MVP on the side, but consider the damage types here. It's Echo, Elise, Karma, an on-hit build Kog'Maw, and the Braum. So it's basically magic damage only coming through from a Freak of Freaks. Wit's End will have that flat shred early in the game, but Aegis is being screamed out for on Jhin Air's side, probably going to be winged picking that up. It's going to be that really interesting spot where maybe we'll have to see Sungyoon go for an early Blade of the Rune King, adjust the build a little bit, because otherwise we're talking literally only magic damage in the late game, and however the scaling, enough magic resist, and maybe you'll be able to weather the storm from the Kog'Maw.
Looks like we just had some mouse issues there for Che. The EU final has infected OGN, I suppose, but we're back in. So nothing to worry about. Everything is taken care of. Now Winged, hovering around in this bottom lane, hasn't shown himself yet.
It's really hard to gank in this situation as Winged. Not in terms of pathing, he'll go for it here, but remember, no extra AD on either of these AD carries.
I haven't seen him, that's gonna be on the hunt pops. Songyu, nice flash, will dodge out of the body slam. Snowflower will be able to jump away. They had to expend all four of their summoners, though Winged not even having to flash off that body slam. So that's just going to be straight profit for Jhin Air in the bottom lane.
The point I wanted to make was, because there's no AD on the Sivir, compared to every other time you've ganked a bot lane at 11 minutes, your Sivir is doing a lot less damage because of the no shopping. So even if Winged got the casket, I think that Sivir with just base damages wouldn't have had enough to take anyone down. As Sungwon looking for Trace, but Trace, ever the defensive mind of top laner.
Yeah, that has been the case for him for as long as we can really remember.
That's a first shop if I ever saw one. Berserker Greaves in a Wit's End.
Didn't really get a chance to look at it, but now Mickey getting engaged on it. Whoa. He just gets deleted, completely taken out. That's going to be the cancel TP from Lindorong, but man, Mickey already was pretty low on the HP, but he just got absolutely annihilated by that Frozen Tomb. The Body Slam Drunken Rage combo from Wing.
Yeah, with some magic was just being popped that fast is surprising, but I guess with the Rune Glaive completed and just a Fiendish Codex for offensive stats. Nice job by Jhinair. Trying to hold down Mickey, who, as we know, has been pretty much relentlessly pushing for the first 12 minutes of this game.
Yeah, that's going to give Kuzan the opportunity to catch back up. Now 109 CS across the board in mid. Mickey going to lose out on that wave that would have given him back a lead. Obviously opted in for the cleanse and just wasn't enough to keep him alive in that circumstance. Didn't even get to use the flash. Just took too much damage in such a short period of time. So now going to be that down that summoner spell. He's going to come back in, but he won't really be able to shove in this lane to deny too many CS away from Kuzan, so they should still just trade back evenly and hover around, you know, one or two CS between each other.
Once Karma's had the pressure, I would like to see Afrika, now that their AD carry is shoved, make a play towards the Drake. It's a Cloud Drake to open things up, so no Infernals to really get everyone frisky, but when you have the mid lane control, when there are windows where Echo can push in a Gnar, which is certainly not a persistent thing, but happens from time to time, depending on whether the Gnar is out warding. There is some breathing space for some wards, but for now, it might be a turret dive.
Yeah, Missile Voyage coming in on the backside. Che and Winged coming in. Songyun going to be the target. Knocks out away from the tower. He is going to go down, has the passive, but no one is close enough to get popped by the Akathian Surprise. Pilot going to eat that with the spell shield. And they'll be able to get some crucial damage in onto this turret. The minions are low, and Seongwon is in the area, so it looks like they won't be able to finalize this kill, get that first brick gold, but a nice play, and very bold from Jhinair, but it pays off.
This time, the gank was really good time. We talked about Winged having a nice jungle path, but no AD there. Essence Reaver is the straight by, launching into the backline. That offensive Abyssal Voyage is now so much more possible. Really nicely executed by Jhinair, and Winged has been the difference between these two teams. 100% kill involvement, really making this Gragas work.
Yep.
Which is not a assumed thing. Gragas has been in the meta, been a very popular pick in Korea, but Wing this season's actually 2-7 on the pick, so has been focusing on the strongest jungler available, but not actually getting the wins out of it. So in that off time, Jhinair put in the practice and looked a lot more practice, admittedly with comfort picks like the Lissandra, like the Sivir, that were bits and pieces of team comps that were working for Jhinair at the end of the season.
But nicely done. All the same, so Jhinair going to put another kill on the board. 3-1 in that regard, up 600 gold. But that first brick hasn't come into play. And if they can get another push in onto that bottom side, they should be able to take out that tower. As Lindorong, though he has been really harassing Trace out, has that 20 CS lead, hasn't really been able to get too much damage in onto the top lane turret himself. It's really just been the minions chipping that one down.
Someone walk up.
Trying to check the brush. Wait, Kuzan know that he's here. The Frozen Tomb's available. He's just going to drop a pink in that middle brush in the river and then go ahead and back off.
Really excited to see the mid game in this game. We have really interesting break evens where Jhinair's comp is, again, a very much traditional Rocks Tigers 1-3-1 split push comp. Sivir in the mid lane wave clearing, and Gnar and Lissandra playing global pressures and being very strong teleport playmakers. But Afrika, you know, they've got the Karma, who kind of wants to stay in mid lane near blue buff, doesn't have a teleport of her own. So it's very much going to be what happens when Jhinair start to play the map and what happens when Afrika get that second item, the Hurricane, onto the Kog'Maw and look for team fights. So both teams know what they want to do in about 5 minutes' time, and the team that pulls it off the cleanest will probably get some really big mid-game snowball.
Well, Trace finally getting some good damage in onto this Echo. So behind in CS with the wave crashing in, so Lindorong should
through.
Be able to maintain that. But as you say, the roam up was coming through, but they spot him with that pink horn. He's not going to walk through the brush. So he won't be able to clear it.
He misses the Mantra Q. I see that after.
There was just a regular Q at least, but still does miss that one despite having the vision on Kuzan. Now they're not going to complete. Now Wing collapsing into the mid. They threaten him back with that Glacial Path. Songwon's there to support, and now Che roaming up, hasn't been spotted yet, but just gonna go ahead dip back down to bottom lane. And look at the damage in onto this mid turret. Actually could see first brick come out of mid lane, which is not something very common.
But it's fun how the first brick mind game has evolved, because this is also a very obvious point for Jhin'Er to counter game, because you know how important first brick is to Afrika. Everyone can see the turret HP, and it's going to be very clear that Afrika, and specifically Mickey, are going to be really overextending to poke around it, and we could very easily see 4v4 or 5v5 action, because just like an Infernal Drake, a low HP first turret is a flashpoint for a fight.
Yeah, for sure. So that could give Jhin'Er some good counterplay potential, because they know that Afrika Freaks are going to want to knock this down. So they could set up for another Abyssal Voyage pinch from behind and just try to turn the fight. Suddenly a 2v2 goes to a 4v2. But it looks like actually bottom lane might be the staging ground for this first brick, and it will be. Violet just shoving Songyun back. Snowflower's not in the lane, and it's going to be the first turret going over. Mickey's still trying to finish off the one in mid, but they're not able to find it in time. So that's going to be a big burst of gold going over to Jhin'Er Green Wings.
There was a small window there where actually Afrika could have just mantra shielded and try to tank out and do the last 300 hit points of damage, but the clear call wasn't there to go for an answering play in mid. Instead, there was a bit of roaming and a bit of happy feeding between Mickey and Songwon. So turret advantage to Jhin'Er, and as you can see, the top lane now, some items are coming through, going well for the knock.
Trace starting to come online, splitting that build a little bit, opted in for the Ninja Tommy to try and deny some of this just auto attack damage coming from the Echo, but it's splitting between that Black Fever and the Spirit Visage. So a little interesting in that regard. When we saw Impact winning this one, it was the Frozen Mallet into the Black Fever. Obviously wants to mitigate a little bit more damage people relevant in the team fights because you have that triple AP threat. And I mean, even the Kog'Maw going to be doing a hell of a lot of AP damage with his on-head build. So the Spectre's Cowl will get him a lot of mileage. But even so, going to be a bit delayed. We'll see which one he wants to complete first. I'm going to guess that he's probably going to do the Spectre's Cowl since he's already starting to win out this lane with just the Phage. But could go for that Black Cleaver.
Yeah, I think that's a pretty good summation. In general, Trace is normally the defensive-minded player, so the tank item first, given that he's doing fine in the trades, makes a lot of sense given the actual player on the field. But Gnar is up there with the Gragas as a pick that Jhin'Er have played a lot but not won with. I believe he's on sub-20% win rate with the Gnar, despite his mechanics being fine and lame, because in general, Jhin'Er haven't played smartly with meta power picks. That's why the 614 and previous meta was so unkind to Jhin'Er. Their season tipped, if you remember, on 611 when the Triforce carries came to top lane. So Jhin'Er had their offseason time, and they're finally starting to put their team comps together, and maybe just at the right time. There is a world where Jhin'Er goes to Worlds.
Yep. Yeah, that took a stupid amount of time to kill that turret, how low it was, but that's what happens when you have this on-hit Kog'Maw, this structural damage isn't going to be very significant. Jhin'Er now moving over to this Cloud Drake. 20-minute mark will be our first one coming through, so only going to get a couple dragons in this game. And then the Elder will be spawning. We'll see what the second one's going to be. It's going to be another Cloud Drake.
Standard lanes have kind of been the death of the pre-15-minute turret take. You don't get the breathing room. Are you doing lane slots to take those turrets? Speaking of breathing room, Trace wailing away on the Echo.
Still falling behind. I mean, having that kill makes up for a bit of the deficit that Lindorong has put him in. But overall, Jhin'Er in a pretty decent spot here. 21 minutes about to hit on the board, and they're about 1,000 gold up, so still nothing that isn't surmountable by Afrika Freaks.
So those items starting to come through for Jhin'Er. Spectre's Cowl we talked about already on Trace, who has gone offensive, actually, with the Black Cleaver finish, but Aegis, we said that was a key item.
Yep.
Magic Resist has come through from 4 out of the 5 members of Jhin'Er, and the efficiency of those purchases will only go up, given, as we said, almost exclusive magic damage from Afrika Freaks.
That looked odd. I'm guessing that was a hop to the right as he got stunned up, so he just kind of glided over.
How are you feeling about 5v5 action in the top lane? Everyone's there.
Oh, well, it's probably not going to happen because Jhin'Er will be like, oh, this is more than we have, so we're going to go ahead and back off.
Let's mock them for making the measured play.
No, I know. They're just always very cautious.
Would you prefer they fought over nothing else in particular? We do see other regions where that happens.
China.
Yep.
I mean, that G2 final was also pretty hammy at points.
becoming one of us, Killia.
I think I've been. I've been here long enough. Kind of fitting into the mold of
LCK. But I mean,
LCK.
Both of us, we kind of had to shake off our previous. Remember, I came from LPL casting. I was molded in LPL before I came.
You were born in it?
Well,
molded
in it.
By it?
In multiple different ways. The start of my career and the start of my professional casting career was Chinese League of Legends. So I needed that detoxing period to get over the fact that we're not fighting all the time.
And the
kills,
OPL.
The kills never match the minutes in this league, unfortunately. And the LMS is pretty shenanigans filled as well.
Yeah. AHQ, they had plenty of shenanigans. They can't pull it off anymore, though, fortunately. Their nice level 5 play that they would go for. But now, gonna have a shove up into the lane here by a Freak of Freaks. Of course, at tier 2.
It's in a nice spot, but no Gnar bar.
Yeah, doesn't have that one built up. Still exhausted by the look of it because he didn't build anything off of that swing of the boomerang. So he's just gonna go for that skull crap. Clear that out, try to build up as best as he can by the look of it. Now running back up.
Sandra has some wards for a teleport flank here. Still no Gnar bar, though.
Starting to build it up, so he's not exhausted anymore. Jump forward's gonna take a little bit of damage. Wing going in, they knock in Songyun. He's gonna flash out. Parallel convergence coming in. Will stun up too. Trace now threatening. Guzon comes to the back, locks him down, trying to find Songyun. He will get Pop Pilot, finds the kill. Trace with a big Gnar ultimate. Won't get the stuns, but still displaces them long enough for Jhin Air to come in and clean up. 3 kills going over to them, and they're not done yet. Maybe looking for more. Pilot is still relatively healthy. Now they're pushing in, but Mickey has the wave clear, so they won't be able to find this tier 1 turret in mid. But nicely played by Jhin Air. Fantastic flank from Kuzan.
But remember, Freak is playing the Protect the MVP game. Might as well be a Counter-Strike offshoot right here, because
Pilot,
the moment that Songyun dies, the team comp falls apart. And you wonder about Afrika. We talked about how they have a little bit of trouble executing, and there's pink wards from Jhin Air sticking. In general, their flanks weren't expertly warded, and you need to move your vision line if you're going to group as 5, and that's what allowed Lissandra to get into the back line. There should never be a flank ward for Lissandra to get into the back line if you've decided that this is the time for 5v5 fight. Rest in peace, Kog'Maw. Rest in peace, Afrika Freaks.
I mean, not only that, but you should never have Songyun in a position where he could just get straight body slammed by a Gragas. Wasn't behind anybody, was up in the front on that left-hand side. And Wing saw his opening and he took it. And the Freak of Freaks, they certainly paid for it. Now going to be down 3,300 gold. Where before, just 4 minutes ago, this was only 1,000, so.
And just think of the, look at the items that were completed off the back of that team by win. Spirit Visage, Locket, and a second Aegis from the Braum. They know exactly what they need to do here, Jhin Air. Stack the magic resist and force Songyun to change his build. Force him to build Blade of the Ruined King. Force the efficiency of the Rageblade build that was so popular, that is very strong on low magic resist targets. When the magic resist starts to stack up, the damage really starts to go down for the Kog'Maw.
Yeah, and speaking of knowing what you need to do, Kuzan especially going for that. Zhonya's as a second item. Just wants to get into the thick of the fight, drop that Frozen Tomb down on himself and buy time for Jhin Air to just sweep in, especially with Pilot on this Sivir, and just clean house. And we saw it right there in action. It worked out insanely well.
If you stick the wards, come in from different flanks on the Gnar and the Lissandra, someone's going to get on top of the Kog'Maw. For now, no QSS. For now, the AP value is a little bit lower for Mickey, so the shields might not be enough. And yeah, every team fight where Songyun is one of the first names to die. So are the hopes of Jhin Air winning this game buoyed, because that's really what they need to do, take out the Kog'Maw.
Yep. And Trace with that magnificent Gnar ultimate, couldn't get the stuns, but again, it was enough of a displacement to knock him back up the lane and finalize a couple more kills. It's going to be 2-1 and 2 on the Gnar. Still down in CS, but making up for it across the map. And now Jhin Air going to be posturing up in mid. Maybe looking to get some damage in onto that tower, but looks like they're just going to clear the wave. Maybe get ready to move down, pick up the second Cloud Drake that's spawning up in about 6 seconds.
Not a lot of map control at all for Afrika. You can see Kog'Maw has to stay close to his outer top lane turrets. They're just pushing because they don't really have the vision to safely take any turrets, even though they saw 3 members in mid. They're only able to push the minion wave in and then just reassess. So, winning the last few skirmishes has forced Afrika to be mostly on the back foot. Finally getting aggressive, but will they even necessarily take down this turret?
4 members up here to the 2 of Jhin Air, but Shay and Pilot are roaming up. They have the Abyssal Voyage, and looks like they're going to take it. Just coming in straight in underneath the turret. Not looking try to come in for a flank. They just want to hold on to this structure, not pick a fight. Well, they buy some time for Trace to get a split onto this tier 2 in bottom. Linderong's wrapping around. There's not that parallel convergence, but Trace is able to just sidestep that one. We'll trade back some damage onto this Echo. He's in a really good spot with that Blade of Ruin King, with that Spirit Visage. So he is going to be perfectly fine in this 1v1.
The big question is, how does Linderong play out fights? Because against a Jhin, against an Ashe, Echo can just disrupt the AD carry, zone them from a fight, but Sivir fights with her tank lines, gonna be aggressive, so Echo's not able to get lane pressure against the Gnar, difficult matchup for him. Team fights, hard for him to really zone out any damage, like we saw Perks doing so well for G2 yesterday in the EU Grand Final, and these are the 1v1s, and they don't look very pretty for the Echo.
Yep, Trace barely making it out of that parallel convergence, can't get that last hit for the Hyper proc, but he'll still trade back a good deal of damage. Use the Gnar ultimate, so it's going to be down for a little bit. So if a fight does break out in this top lane and he TP's in, he's not going to be able to have that big stun into the wall. Now Pilot going low. Has to get devoured up by Che. He'll stay safe for the time being, but Jhin Air getting less and less likely that they can hold onto this turret.
They ping out Lissandra. They know her positioning here.
Trying to find the pick. At least get some damage in, because Kuzan still does offer up a good amount of wave clear. And then Pilot is backed off, but I think with this wave, Jhin Air, they're probably just going to have to surrender this turret over to a Freak of Freaks.
They've delayed a 200-300 Hell Tower for a really long time. This is probably the time, like you said. There it goes.
Yeah. Let's hand that one over. Trace has gotten more than enough damage onto that tier 2 by now. And Jhin Air, they lose the structure, but they can go ahead, just reset, clear their heads. Prep vision around Baron, and then likely move down and take a second dragon.
That delay has bought enough time for Pilot, 3-0-1, the main benefactor of the early game, to get the Infinity Edge. Three item Sivir is what we always talk about in this here. And yeah, Frieza caught in rotation. Gonna walk up and get the mid lane tower, which is a really nice prize.
They're gonna get two of them. Kuzan's still in top. Oh, he's stuck around, and he's gonna be able to clear this one out with the wave that's present.
Consider how long Afrika spent trying to take down 300 hit points coming out of turret, and they just watch as Jhin Air casually take two, and hell, why not start off for Drake as well?
Yeah, Jhin Air just profiting across the board right now. Three objectives gonna be picked up. Second Cloud Drake for them. Elder, of course, gonna be the next one to spawn.
And you know why this happened to Killios? They spent so much time in top that you can't see a blue ward on the map because they weren't able to put them down. They were very transparently trying to brute force down a low health turret. Jhin Air used two members at first to hold on, then it sent more members, but prepped their vision, allowed them to make the much cleaner rotations, and everywhere was danger for Afrika because they had no vision outside of what the minions in lane were going to provide.
Well, now if you're Afrika Freaks, going to have several things running through your head, but the biggest question is going to be, how do we get back into this game? What objective plays can we make? There's still the tier 1 turret in bottom. It's just under a 4,000 gold lead for Jhin Air, so again, it's not that massive now that we're at that 30-minute mark, but it's still a bad spot to be in.
I mean, the awkward thing for Afrika is, you know, as with all these Juggernaut comps, they don't really have initiation. They kite back very well. They team fight well. But what is actually on the map that Jhin Air are going to opt into a team fight? You could say Baron, but actually Afrika's Baron damage short of Pugmore is very low. Karma doesn't do a lot of damage to Baron, so you'd imagine Jhin Air aren't going to be sucked into a bad fight around Baron. And then every other objective, including the Drake, is off the map. So Afrika, really, are only just pushing in minion waves and backing away, or they're overextending, and then we just look for a repeat Lissandra teleport.
Well, looks like they might be looking to go for this turn in mid. Actually, you have the fast track on this one. Kuzan recalling, might be looking for another flank, and now Wings coming in from behind. They're going to go ahead, TP this one out. On the hunt is popped to Jhin Air. They're going to try to find this fight. Trace, no Narvar built up. Kuzan comes in, locks down Song Yun. He gets melted out. Trace finds the final blow. Kuzan going straight into that zone. He's keeping himself alive, and Mickey is going to go down. Flash forward for the Ring of Frost with the Snowflower. He is going to be made relatively quick work of. Will flash over the wall to juke out that boomerang blade, but here comes Jay and Pilot in with the Abyssal Voyage, and that is Songwon going down. Kuzan able to finish off the Braum in the back line, and Linderong is going to be the only remaining member of Afrika Freaks that is still healthy, that is still alive. And Jhin Air, with that quad kill picked up, losing nobody, they're going to turn over to this Baron.
That's really nice when Afrika make my point for me. They realize, well, we want to fight, but I guess we're going to have to force a fight around the inner turret. They don't have any vision prepped. Lissandra, Gnar all get the world's best flank. Good job by a Wing to buy time for them, just with the explosive cast to group everyone. Pugmore face checks a Lissandra. And there goes Afrika's chance of winning this game.
It just goes to show you get into this teamfight phase, and now Trace buys the Frozen Mallet because he's so far ahead at this point.
But the problem is Afrika want a teamfight phase. That's what they love. If we could put a big highlight and say teamfight phase, they're ready to brawl 5v5. It's just, what is Jhinnair going to fight over? There wasn't objectives. The Drakes have been taken down. The Baron with a Karma is very hard to take. So the only way for them to get a fight is basically to push as aggressively and recklessly as possible. And that opens up the double teleport to have a field day with the backline of Afrika.
Well, what was once 4,000 gold is suddenly going to be bordering on 8. As Jhinnair start to really run away with this game, and this is much more concise play than we are used to seeing from these guys, given their record in summer, not making it into the playoffs this time around. But it looks like that extended break that they had, 23 days since their last game, it's looking like it might have worked out for them, and it looks like Afrika Freaks might have gone on a little bit of a vacation.
I mean, Jhinnair's last game of the season against ESC Ever, the win that confirmed they would not be going to relegations. They played Lissandra Jhin, they played very cleanly, and they did it at a good time. And you're like, okay, it's one game. They had such a long lull in the season that you're like, whatever, you know, just write it off. This is that same Jhinnair. They're performing well, they're performing smartly, their draft makes sense, and it's very meta, and they can play all these champions to a good level. This wasn't the Jhinnair we saw a month ago, but this is the Jhinnair that came so close to going to Worlds in 2015, even if some of the members have changed.
Can you imagine if we have that similar run coming through from Jhinnair, beating the Afrika Freaks here, beating Samsung later on in the weekend?
I mean, the Worlds qualifiers. The Worlds qualifiers are a weird beast, Achilles. 2 years ago, Najin Shield ran from the bottom to take out SK Telecom and other contenders to make it to an unlikely World Championship. And last year, Jhinnair almost replicated that. So often we have a team from this first match run the gauntlet or come damn close.
Well, Jhinnair putting up a strong argument for that. At this moment, Parallel Convergence comes out, but Jhinnair is able to back away, and they get a lot of damage in onto that tier three turret here in mid. Trace just gonna continue applying pressure in bottom with these Baron Empowered minions. Gets chunked out a little bit on the Gnar. Goes into Mega, he'll be all right. Looks like he's gonna rotate up, join the rest of his squad as they knock down that first inhibitor tower. The inhibitor is likely to follow.
There's just nothing Afrika can do. They don't have initiation. Jhinnair aren't interested in overextending. I'm going to see the Sivir ult pop, but getting away is pretty trivial for Jhinnair.
Having that Devour available with the Sivir ultimate, just peeling back, Gragas Cask as well. The disengage options are just completely there for Jhinnair.
Very much a meanwhile that situation. Afrika have to force a fight to just get anything from this game.
Committing in on the Wink, but he's still down a half HP, trying to get out of there, but there's no Devour available from Chase, so they will actually pick up their second kill. Now Pilot getting jumped on. They'll find two kills, but they're going to lose an inhibitor over this one as Trace has just been sticking around in the bottom lane. So two kills picked up for Afrika Freaks. Good for you guys. But now you have Super Creeps pushing in on that bottom wave, and you're still down by 11,500 gold.
And I think the last point you made that's probably the most important, the bottom wave. This is the bottom turret's gone down.
So as far from Baron as possible.
Exactly. The Baron will be responding. Just a couple of minutes. Third Drake. Expect to go over to the side of Jhinnair as well. Actually, the Elder Dragon, my apologies, given the late spawns. But that's the kind of the call they made. They could have tried to spare the blush. I think they could have still won a team fight, even though Winged basically surrendered his whole health bar just to buy time for the Gnar. But they called off Trace, ended up not fighting for it. And even if Afrika could take down this dragon, remember, they have no Drake buffs to buff it up.
Yeah, they're not going to be profiting much from this one. If they're able to secure it, it's down to about half HP. Wing now respawning, so it comes down to a steal from Trace. I think they kind of just had to let this one go or try to contain Afrika Freaks around this pit and then go for an extended engagement, but with Pilot running up to the top side of the map, get that red buff, they're just gonna let that Elder go over. Not too much lost here for Jhinnair.
This is very much Afrika taking away what should have been a free Elder Dragon from Jhinnair, rather than actually getting themselves a win condition of their own. They have 90 seconds of power, the minimum amount of power that the Elder Dragon can provide because they have no Drakes to buff it up. And there's not even a Baron they can force a fight around in those 90 seconds. And we've gone over a couple of times. There isn't much initiation. There's not much that Jhinnair will want to fight over. And the Baron is the only objective on the map that might actually draw a contest from Jhinnair.
Yep. So still just a rough spot to be in here for the Afrika Freaks. As we can see, 2 minutes on the clock for Baron to come back up. And Jhinnair pretty much going to be poised to take that, because look at that top side of the map. There are almost zero wards by Afrika Freaks. One pink sitting inside their own jungle, but still very shallow. Not going to be getting them any vision of the river or of Jyn Air's jungle, so they just have not been able to push out. Completely relegated inside of their own base.
Jokomor is about shredding a front line, but even though he's hit four items on the Cogmore, including the Rage Blade, that increases the efficiency of those on hits with the Phantom hit every couple of autos. Look at that front line of Jyn Air. Double magic resist, including a Guardian Angel on both Trace and Wend. Kuzan pretty tanky in the ability to go into stasis himself. And what that actually translates to in team fights is that one of Trace, Wingo, Kuzan will step up and buy time for the flankers to come through, and they won't die because they've already put together a lot of magic resist and even things like double Warden's Mail now that work really well against the Cog.
Yeah, I mean, the double lock-in is just going to be keeping the members of Jyn Air alive so long in these fights. And now that Bloodthirster for Violet, he is looking to never die. Now working on that last Whisper. We'll see if he wants to Lord Dominix or the Mortal Reminder. Could go for either.
That was a full rotation from Songwon, and I believe he did about 200 damage to the Gnar.
Yeah, Trace just shrugging that one off. Not going to hurt him too much. And looks like we're going to have another pause, so could have another mouse issue coming through for Che. We'll find out what the issue is and get this taken care of and move back into this game. This might be a tactical pause by Afrika Freaks, just trying to buy some time, clear their mental state
to come
back in.
We don't have tactical pauses.
I know.
In competitive League of Legends. I'm sure almost all the fans know that, but
they're just pretending to have an issue.
I mean, there are other esports that have tactical pauses, so.
Yeah.
Just thought I'd mention it. I believe if you call a pause for a non-legit reason, then you do receive some sort of ban, like a losing a ban in a future game.
Yeah.
So not something taken lightly, and it's worth noting that
it's not something a Korean team would do.
I mean, you say that, but it's interesting that Jyn Air are the only team to actually have a black mark next to their name, as if you remember.
That's true.
Because both Trace and, I believe, Pilot, I might tell
you
later.
It was Trace and Pilot.
But yeah, Trace and Pilot left games before the Nexus exploded. You know, the whole a summoner has left the game as the Nexus explodes. They actually lost a point, and that pushed them further and further, their game difference down, and further towards relegation. So
yeah.
Not a common occurrence in the league for sure, but certainly does happen from time to time.
It's considered unsportsmanlike conduct. So
BM.
Have to get some punishment going for that sort of thing. We've seen that in North America as well. Dardoch has done that a plethora of times.
Has he now?
As it fits the role.
Oh, Dardoch.
I love the kid, but he's still young, has a lot of growing up to do. But
he's good at that League of Legends thing, though.
He's pretty damn good at that League of Legends thing, whatever that is.
I don't know. Right now, I don't get to watch League of Legends. I get to watch League of Paws.
Unfortunately, the whole of Team Liquid isn't that great at that League of Legends thing at the moment.
Maybe they're going to make a big run with Killios.
That's true. I could hope for that. I still love the team. Just,
NA Coster.
You know. Come on, man. I used to work for the org. I have to have some, patriotism's not the word, but
I'm
support.
I'm going to use patriotism.
Yeah.
Liquid patriotism.
The country of Team Liquid.
Yes.
But, yeah, it looks like issue might be inside of Afrika Freaks' booth. So, not exactly certain what's going on, but we have the refs in there, and they should be taking care of this one. It's got some foreign fans coming out to play today, checking out the first day.
Look who it is!
Oh!
Foreign players, too!
Yeah!
Ganked by a mom.
We just got everybody.
We're going to have to talk to him during the break.
Yeah, we'll have to go say hello. I mean, we saw him during the last playoffs for Jyn Air.
We didn't see him at the LCK final. He was supposed to be on Dangun's weekly LCK,
yeah,
but you
right.
know the story here.
Yeah, so actually GPM came to Korea, was going to go to the final, but he thought that the final was on Sunday instead of Saturday. So he woke up realized as the final was starting, like, oh, wait, it was today. Say, sorry, I can't make it.
It's his loss, man. That was a sick final.
It was. It was a damn good final. I mean, we had, of course, Wolf and Bang and all of SK Telecom in attendance. Not Legacy SKT. Piglet didn't come out to say hello.
He was the man that carried Jyn Air to what was almost the world's most unlikely qualification for the World Champs, and maybe he's the good luck charm they need for today.
So you can say he carried them to their shortcomings.
Well, almost qualifying, still better than being eliminated in the first round.
Sounds a lot worse when he's saying it like that, but now Engage coming in. Pilot going to go low, actually going to get picked off as Lindorong dives into the back line with a face dive. We'll finish him off. Kuzan having to go out with a Glacial Bath. And Jhin Air, they're actually losing this fight. They lock up Jay with the concussive blows. He falls, still jumping onto this Lissandra. One more Glacial Bath will take him out to safety. But two kills picked up by a Freak of Freaks, winning a fight that they had no business taking away.
Yeah, Freak actually got an initiation for once, and Jhin Air had not prepped their sideways. They hadn't prepped their abilities. Trace was exhausted as the fight started, so couldn't get any sort of Gnar ultimate. And although he can buy some breathing room, allow the respawn timers to come through, Freaka trying to drill down the Baron.
Yeah, they're going to try to go for this one. Kuzan, though, comes in with a teleport. This is still going to be Trace coming in, has that Meganar. They're going to peel off, wait till he gets exhausted yet again. Winged is still waiting over the side, so they won't be able to actually go for this Baron. And Kuzan gets the exit off of that claw. So Freaka Freaks picking up two kills, can't get the Baron, but they have signs of life coming in just 40 minutes into this game.
Trace looking to stop any backs as well, as we saw the minions from the double inhibitors being down. One respawns, I say that.
Jhin Air might just try to hound this out on the Baron.
I mean, Trace is just trying to buy time for them to take Baron.
Yeah,
I mean,
he's pushing
someone
back.
Away.
He's going to have to recall Jhin Air. They're going to start to something, beard out the vision.
Sivir someone, he melt is, this Baron.
Yeah, he is not going to arrive in time. This is a Baron going over to Jhin Air yet again. Nicely done by Trace, just completely denying the backs from everybody on a Freak of Freaks, buying that crucial period of time necessary to get Pilot and Jay back up.
And again, Juggernaut is very powerful in the late game. We just saw Freaka win a team fight more than 10,000 gold behind, but it can do some things that can't do others. When you only have one damage threat, a chunked out Elise and a Kog'Maw. We're going to see the replay here, but the Baron was just too hard for them. This is Sangyun for once getting to free hit. No one's teleporting behind him because he's in his own base, so Kog'Maw free hitting, despite all the magic which is stacking, does a lot of damage. Trace is exhausted, but the fact that Freaka couldn't get a big win from this, with so little Baron damage, it would have taken too long and Winged was a level over. The smart of them to pull away, but even trying that Baron allowed Jhin Air the time to set up and take it themselves. So Freaka punished, even though that was the best moment of the first 40 for them.
Yeah, for sure. And now with this Baron buff coming in, Trace splitting in the bottom side of the map, things are just going to get worse and worse for Freaka Freaks, and we could see the end of the game coming up here.
Trace once again.
Yeah, he's just going to walk straight past the wave. Knows that he has the minions to push that up. But Freaka, they're going to try to pick a fight. Well, they have the 5v4,
how do
but
you
they're
pick
just
a
gonna
fight?
Lose that inhibitor.
And how do they pick a fight? They can't just blow the Karma speed and actually start a fight. They don't have other initiators, so while they feign aggression, they don't have the tools to actually force things. That's not a comp they pick once again. They just have to let Trace split push a free inhibitor.
Well, mid's gonna be respawning shortly. Now bottom, surging out those super creeps yet again. Freaka Freaks is holding on by this one final thread. Jhin Air, they have the scissors, gonna look to snip that thing in half. Trace still pinching up from below. Kuzan there as well, and Freaka Freaks desperately trying to hold on to this final inhibitor turret. The creeps now coming into mid yet again. Bottom lane moving up as well. Where is the Hail Mary? They need to try something. But it's just so difficult for Freaka to try to start this engagement.
Jhin Air just really need to have Trace have the Gnar bar in the right spots. Build it up now. Let's see if he's going to rotate over and fight, because this time, he's ready to initiate.
He's being cleared out yet again. Wayne getting slowed up, so also Guardian Angel. So, he's also a very tanky Gragas. He's not going to be going down unless all members of the Freaka Freaks are able to pile onto him. Trace is just keeping this Echo busy. Moving up the creeps, trying to get onto that Nexus turret. It's already down to about half HP. He gets a couple seconds open on that. He'll be able to burn through it relatively quickly. As you can see the damage coming through right there. That draws Mickey away, and now the rest of Jhin Air are going to move in, take out this turret. Wayne takes a bunch of damage, will get the Vower. Jay getting popped up. Has the shield. It's not able to proc it in time, actually. Songyun's going to go down to now Kuzan. Getting engaged on a couple more hits will proc the concussive blows, go straight into the Zonias, but there's just no hope for him to get out of here. He is going to go down another two kills, picked up for a Freak of Freaks, but they lose that turret at the Nexus. They hold on to the one in front of the inhibitor, but they're still just losing out on bigger objectives despite getting these kills.
All right, my optimism's starting to go for Jhin Air, Akilios. Once again, Gnar is just taking down a Nexus turret instead of just actually rotating over with the Gnarbar. They can turret dive. They have massively tanky front lines with Guardian Angel, but instead they seem to be happy with continuing to split push when team fighting. You know, pop the Sivir ult, have Gnar rush in with a Gnarbar, you're gonna get the top lane inhibitor. Instead, they're giving up free kills, and even though Afrika haven't been able to translate that necessarily into a way to win the game, you lose a couple more fights, death time has got long enough, and Afrika will be knocking on your Nexus in the next 10 minutes.
I mean, this just gives Afrika Freaks that much more gold to soak up and nullify the lead that's been coming through from Jhin Air, because we're hitting that point where even though they have 10,000 up, six items are going to be coming through from multiple people on both sides. Trace, he actually gets caught by that cocoon. Parallel convergence sword down. He's going to flash away to keep himself safe. Now TP coming in the back as Kuzan is looking for the pinch, but he's going to cancel it at the last second as the rest of Jhin Air was not prepared for that fight. See the recall coming through from Pilot now. Second Elder Dragon getting ready to spawn in a minute. Freaka Freaks could take that away just to deny an objective away from Jhin Air. They're still not going to benefit from it too much.
So I'm just going for blue, so she's not in position for a home guard teleport flank. Couple of wards she can teleport to, but for once the threat onto Sangyun's a little bit lower.
Oh, that's going to be Wing coming forward, gets cocooned yet again. Trace trying to build up that Gnarbar, goes pretty low. Sangyun getting chunked out. Kuzan goes in, locks him down. The Frozen Tomb's completely just going to pop him with the help of the rest of the team. He falls. Abyssal Voyage now to try to cut them off in the back line as they try to exit. Glacial Fissure will get thrown out, knocks up Kuzan and Jay, but it doesn't matter. Snowflower is still going to go down. And now Jhin Air, with Zhongyun dead, with Snowflower gone, they're going to be pushing straight down this mid lane to try to end the game.
Jhin Air in the opponent's base didn't really seem to have much of a clue on how to win the game, but if a Freaker push out far enough, they find the angles, they kill the Kog'Maw. Yeah, with only a single Nexus turret alive and still 30 seconds in the Kog'Maw, this should be game one for Jhin Air.
Yeah, I mean, Songwon trying to deny the wave in mid, but the super creeps are still there in bottom. One last Nexus turret standing, and Trace keeping everybody stuck inside of the fountain. Turret goes down, and that's going to be the Nexus exposed. Lindorong trying to do some damage, but it's just not going to happen. He'll get his GA popped, as will Songwon, and that will be game one. Going over to the Jhin Air in 46 minutes. A bit of an early game for them by their standards. But they will take that down, and Afrika Freaks finally showing some signs of life later on in the set. But Jhin Air, coming out the gate, looked very concise, faltered a bit throughout, but they're able to close it out all the same.
Ironically, the first 30 minutes is actually where Jhin Air looked the best. They definitely looked to not understand how to close things when they got into the enemy base. Felt too long that they were split-pushing with Trace, even though we had the team fight in our build, and they had a big two-man tank wall. The turret dive, so definitely not time for smiles, and of course still very early in what could be a best of five that goes all five games, but more good than bad for Jhin Air to ruminate on. And Afrika, they went for the Juggernaut, predictably didn't really know how to win with it, and ended up losing game one.
Yeah, we'll see what's going to happen. We'll see what sides these guys are going to choose.
We'll wait and see who plays in game two.
Yeah, that's true. We could see Lyra and Ixu coming back out from the side of Afrika Freaks, taking a look at the damage. Trace doing some work on the Gnar, coming in second place overall damage dealt to champions. Pilot leading the board at 34,000 in that game. So doing some strong work for the AD carry, who normally doesn't contribute a whole lot given how many resources he's poured in.
Yep, game one to Jhin Air, but could mean so little to Killios. Think we're going long and late tonight.
It would seem that way. Take a look at some of these replays, though. We have these fights. Kuzan's the last pickoff, just absolutely destroying Sangyun.
There's no Lulu in this team. These comps have changed quite a bit. So, predictably, with Braum's shield down, with Vicky's shield ostensibly on cooldown, we didn't have the confirmation there. Left out to dry is Sangyun. And when you're defending in your base next to your Nexus turrets, nowhere to be flanked. Unless you're looking for that turret dive that Jhin Air clearly seems scared to do. But in that scenario, pretty straightforward to kill the Kog'Maw and push forward.
Yep. All right, well, we're going to get ready to go to a break, but when we come back, we will have game two. We'll see if Jhin Air can keep it up or if Afrika Freaks are going to make this a series. So don't go anywhere, guys. We'll be back in just a couple minutes.